It's going to happen. Good morning. It's good to be able to get together for worship this morning. Delighted to be able to draw together. As we come, let me just share a couple of verses from Psalm chapter 5. But let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them ever sing for joy and spread your protection over them, that those who love your name may exalt in you. For you bless the righteous, O Lord. You cover him with favor as with a shield.
Thank you. Hello, good morning, and welcome to church this morning. If you're visiting with us, a special welcome to you. If you're new to 10th, do keep your bulletin handy as we use words you'll find in pronounced print in a moment or two for prayer and praise. Whenever God's people gather, we gather under the Word of God. We're summoned by Him to gather as His covenant community. And so God's Word begins our worship and ends our worship. Let's hear the Word of God. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a garment, stretching out the heavens like a tent. He makes the clouds his chariot. He rides on the wings of the wind. He makes his messengers winds, his ministers of flaming fire. Let's stand. As we come, we're honest with God as we confess our sins together. Let's all pray. O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay. You are the potter. We are all the work of your hands. Forgive us, Lord, for how we have corrupted your good creation. Gracious Lord, you alone are righteous and holy, and in your presence no one can stand. Your gracious mercy is our only hope, and we ask for your forgiveness. We pray for your cleansing touch to wash away our corruption, to clothe us in the righteousness that may only be found by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose holy name we pray. Brothers and sisters, hear these words of gospel assurance. For as far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. We come to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and ask that you might manifest yourself to us today in the reading and especially in the preaching of Holy Scripture, so that we may duly believe in you, yield obedience to you, enjoy fellowship with you, walk in your love and fear, and so come at length to be blessed with you forevermore. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. The psalm that we'll be reading responsively today is Psalm 143. That's found on page 523 in the black Bibles in front of you. Page 523, and we'll be reading Psalm 143. I'll read the odd-numbered verses, and I'll invite you to join with me in reading out the even-numbered verses together. Immediately following the responsive reading, as we usually do, we will stand immediately to sing the ancient hymn to God's glory, Gloria Patri, and then we will join the church throughout the world and down the centuries in confessing the Apostles' Creed together, joyfully saying together what we believe about God. So let's have our responsive reading in Psalm 143, a psalm of David. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Give ear for my pleas for mercy. In your faithfulness, answer me. In your righteousness, enter not into judgment with your servant, for no one living is righteous before you. For the enemy has pursued my soul. He has crushed my life to the ground. He has made me sit in darkness like those long dead. Therefore, my spirit faints within me. My heart within me is appalled. I remember the days of old. I meditate on all that you have done. I ponder the work of your hands. I stretch out my hands to you. My soul thirsts for you like a parched land. Answer me quickly, O Lord. My spirit fails. Hide not your face from me, lest I be like those who go down to the pit. Let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love, for in you I trust. Make me know the way I should go, for to you I lift up my soul. Deliver me from my enemies, O Lord. I have fled to you for refuge. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. For your name's sake, O Lord, preserve my life. In your righteousness, bring my soul out of trouble. And in your steadfast love, you will cut off my enemies, and you will destroy all the adversaries of my soul, for I am your servant. Please stand. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Let's unite our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, how we rejoice to come into your presence today, not only to acknowledge your existence, but to come and worship you, for you have revealed yourself to us, and as such we may come with knowledge as well as with full hearts, for you are not just a truthful tautology, but rather you are our living God, that we may know personally. And Lord, though we may not follow you perfectly, we do pray that you would continue to pour out grace into our lives, that you would teach us day by day what it is to be more like Jesus Christ, to live in a life of obedience as he did, but also to realize the joy that he has of knowing you. So, Lord, we pray that since the door is open now, whereby we may come to know you intimately and personally, we pray that we would make the most of it. So as we gather together, we pray that this time of worship will not only be when we will receive from you, but also when we will give back to you the praise that is due your holy name, that we will praise you for being our God, for being the one who protects and provides for us in all ways, for the one who provides steadfast love day by day, that we may not feel alone or cut off, but rather to belong and to have a place where we are headed. Lord, we give you thanks on this day of remembrance of the attack against this country. And we are reminded again of many who gave the sacrifice, an ultimate sacrifice, to be able to reach out and help to others. Lord, we give you thanks for those who did that at that time, but also who have committed themselves to help in emergency services, those who have helped to work for justice. We pray for your blessing to be upon them. And if they know you, we pray especially that they may be richly blessed because they know that you are the one who provides their strength and their opportunity for being able to reach out in this way. Lord, we give you thanks again for the way that you protect our souls. Though we go through difficult times and difficult situations, you continue to love us and to help support us in that time. We think of many in our congregation itself who have chronic illnesses, not the easy ones, but rather the ones that continue to plague in and out, that may come and ebb and flow. But we thank you for your constancy of love and movement towards us, and ask that indeed that will be the point of satisfaction that we may have. Lord, too, we thank you that we may not just know you, but continually know about you, that you teach us more of yourself day by day. We thank you for those who provide teaching and education, for those who work in the Bible school department with our young children, as well as those who teach adult classes, for those who help in Bible studies throughout the week and who constantly are preparing for ministries and other outreaches that are here. We give you thanks. And we pray again that you will use them in their time of preparation as they spend time before you, that your Spirit may tutor them in what your word says and so be able to bless us and help us in our growth, not only of knowledge, but that we may spend time thinking about it, spend time with you, learning more, pondering this truth, and growing closer to you. Lord, we give you thanks, therefore, for this time of worship where we may gather together, not just for an event, but rather as a community, to come and praise you. And we would ask that during this time you will bless us, not only with your presence, but by your Spirit to encourage, to strengthen, and to hearten. For it is in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Studies. We want to welcome you. Thank you. I've got a voice again. We want to welcome you. Let me reiterate that. Welcome. Glad you're here. But also, it's a great time. If you don't have young children, you will not know this is rally day. And this is the start of the new season that we have. The kids were having a great time upstairs, from what I hear. And so it was wonderful to be able to do that. Also, there are many of the ministries that are beginning at the start of the year. Let me just highlight a few so that you know. First of all, the newly married class, which is those who have been married for just this past weekend, up to about 5 years. The fellowship group is actually going to start in October. That was putting the announcements wrong last week. Hope that you didn't head over to the house. But it will start at the beginning of October, so get ready for that itself. Also, if you have an interest in being able to help serve in a very practical way, today is your day. We have a community fellowship dinner, which happens upstairs in Fellowship Hall following this service. They need extra servers, and it's very easy. You can just pop right in, offer your hands, to be able to reach out. But also, you get the opportunity to know some of our guests who are from the neighborhood themselves. So if you have an interest in doing either of those or both of those together, do plan to come up to Fellowship Hall. You can go through the door and up the stairs, and someone will be there to be able to help you get involved.
The Boyce Center invites you to come to lunch and a conversation with Thomas Hong, who's the director of the Pennsylvania Symphony Orchestra. There's more details in the bulletin about that, but that'll be following the service next door. And also, there are other announcements in the bulletin. I invite you to scour through that, not during the service, but perhaps later on this afternoon, as you would the New York Times Sunday edition, and you will find that there is much to be plumbed for it.
Sunday in the year where we invite our teachers and assistants for our children's Bible school, preschool, primary, junior, junior high, senior high, teachers and assistants in our children's programs that run through our services, Praise Makers, Praise Makers Plus, Catechism Club, 10th Children's Music, Maranatha, coordinators for our nursery and nursery workers, and teachers for all our adult Bible school classes and work with TIFF and all the volunteers who teach various groups throughout our church to stand. That's the end of the thing, to stand. So if you can't come under any of those categories or you think you might, could you stand up, please? All of you, do this. Thank you. So that we can look at you and be grateful for you and thank the Lord for the gifts and graces that he has given to you in the work that you do. And your work is an important work. It's a vital work. Teaching the Bible to whatever age is the most precious thing that we can do for our children, for young people, for other men and women. And I want you to be encouraged in that work and have a sense of the weight of it. It is a great and weighty task. And there's a sense in which those of us who teach the word to others are going to be judged more strictly, so we need to pay attention very carefully to what we teach. That's not to put you off. It's just to make you more persistent, really, in your study and so on. And if you have a question, ask Carol and he'll resolve the question. I have some questions for you now, to all teachers and staff. Believing that you are called by God to the ministry of teaching at 10th Presbyterian Church, do you affirm your own personal faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? Do you? Do you believe the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments as originally given to be the inerrant word of God, the only infallible rule of faith and practice? Do you? Do you sincerely receive and adopt the confession of faith and the catechisms of this church as containing the doctrine taught in the Holy Scriptures? Do you? And will you endeavor, God being your helper, to discharge faithfully the duties and the ministry of teaching at 10th Presbyterian Church? Will you be diligent in study? Will you be regular and punctual in attendance at church and at the Bible school? And will you maintain sympathetic and friendly contacts with your students, earnestly trying by word and example to win them to faith in Jesus Christ and to a life of discipleship? Will you? Now, this privilege and responsibility of guiding the children, young people, and adults of this congregation is not the duty of these teachers alone. So will you, therefore, the fathers and mothers, brothers and sisters, other members of this congregation, recognizing that the primary responsibility for the upbringing of children rests with you, now join these teachers and officers in rededicating yourselves to God and to this task in its faithful fulfillment. Will you? Let me encourage then all of you who teach the word. In these words originally addressed to the ministers of the gospel, but by extension to anyone who handles the word of God, one to a group within the life of the church, I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word or teach it. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. The time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. Father God, we pray for those who teach the Bible here, in whatever context, that you would make them faithful in their study, that you would make them bold in their explanation of it, that you make them sympathetic to those whom they teach, and that you would give them the joy of seeing this, to the praise of your glory. Amen.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you because Jesus Christ won his reward. You vindicated him. You raised him from the dead. And we thank you that we have a part in his reward. And Father, we confess we do not know why we should gain from that reward. But we know that his wounds have paid our ransom. And we thank you very much for that. Father, as we continue to worship you now, bringing our gifts and our offerings to you, would you use these monies to further your kingdom? Would you bring more and more people to gain from the reward of Christ? Would you bless this church and its ministries, the missionaries we support, the various organizations we support, to preach the word, to extend that word throughout the world? Would you build your kingdom? In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
Well, let's take our Bibles this morning and turn to the book of Esther. I think that's page 414 in the Church Bible. Book of Esther, chapter 8. Let's hear the word of God. On that day, King Ahasuerus gave to Queen Esther the house of Haman, the enemy of the Jews. And Mordecai came before the king, for Esther had told what he was to her. And the king took off his signet ring, which he had taken from Haman, and gave it to Mordecai. And Esther set Mordecai over the house of Haman. Then Esther spoke again to the king. She fell at his feet and wept and pleaded with him to avert the evil plan of Haman the Agagite and the plot that he had devised against the Jews. When the king held out the golden scepter to Esther, Esther rose and stood before the king. And she said, "If it please the king, and if I have found favor in his sight, and if the thing seems right before the king, and I am pleasing in his eyes, let an order be written to revoke the letters devised by Haman the Agagite, the son of Hammedatha, which he wrote to destroy the Jews who are in all the provinces of the king. For how can I bear to see the calamity that is coming to my people? Or how can I bear to see the destruction of my kindred?" Then King Ahasuerus said to Queen Esther and to Mordecai the Jew, "Behold, I have given Esther the house of Haman, and they've hanged him on the gallows, because he intended to lay hands on the Jews. But you may write as you please with regard to the Jews in the name of the king, and seal it with the king's ring. For an edict written in the name of the king and sealed with the king's ring cannot be revoked." Right at the heart of the book of Esther, there is a massive conflict in which the powers of light and darkness, the kingdom of this world and the kingdom of our Lord and God, are locked in battle together. And in the cockpit of that battle is Queen Esther. And at the point at which we now enter into the story, she is facing probably the greatest part of the battle. The heat of the battle lies before her. Now, let me remind you, or for some of you who are new this morning, I'll fill you in on the details of the background to this story. It's set in the Persian Empire at a time when most of the Jews who were taken there in exile have gone back to Jerusalem. They're back there by this stage 55 to 60 years. But some have been left littered around the Persian Empire, which runs from India in the east down to Ethiopia in the south, a massive empire. And in the capital, Susa, one of the capitals that was a popular one with this particular king, Xerxes, or Ahasuerus as we know him here, in the capital there, there has arisen a figure called Haman, this one man, a volatile figure, a powerful figure who has ingratiated himself with the king, the emperor, Ahasuerus. This man, Haman, is an enemy of the Jews. We're told that in the very first verse of this chapter. He is the enemy of the Jews. Now, that may be inconsequential to you this morning, and you wonder why on earth that should be a matter of consequence to us. But I remind you what the Bible says of the Jews and how the Jews figure in the history of redemption, that is, in the history of God's working with humanity that leads us to be where we are this morning in a Christian church, worshiping the God of Israel, Yahweh Jesus, the Savior of the world, the Lord Christ, and giving him the praise and glory as we have done so already this morning. Here's how the Apostle Paul describes the Jews in Romans chapter 9. He reminds us that they are Israelites. That is, they're God's people. They are God's chosen. They are kings and priests that God has appointed to himself. And he goes on to describe them. To them belong the adoption. They have a right to call God their father. They are Israel is called the Son of God in the sense that God has given them that privilege and given them an inheritance. To them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, the fathers, and from their race, according to the flesh, is the Messiah, who is God over all, blessed forever. Amen. That's how Paul describes the Jews. So when we read in the first verse that there is an enemy of the Jews, and when we go on to discover that this enemy of the Jews has plotted and schemed and planned their eradication entirely, we are to understand that the whole history of redemption, the whole work of God that culminates in the coming of the Messiah, rests upon the survival of these Jews as a people. For when the Messiah comes, he will say to a Samaritan woman, "Salvation is of the Jews." When you go back to the beginning of the Bible, as we've seen repeatedly in this series, at the end of the book of Genesis, there we're told that it is from the Jews that the royal scepter will come. That is, that the royal family will come. And through one member of that royal family, all the nations of the world will be gathered to God. That one figure being the Messiah, who was born of the house of David in the clan of Judah. He was a Jew. In other words, the very future of the world as we know it, our future as followers of Jesus the Messiah, rests on the events of Esther, which is why the book of Esther is in the Bible, which is why it's celebrated by Jews, because it was a great deliverance for them, and it should be celebrated by us as Christians, because the future unfolding of God's plan and purposes is in the balance. That's really where we enter the story as we have it now. It comes, as we see, on that day. What day is that? Well, that is the day in which this enemy of the Jews, has received his comeuppance. He has been hung. Very interesting that this man Haman, who had drawn up the edict to annihilate the Jews, has, over the past couple of chapters we've seen his purpose and plan begin to fall apart as Queen Esther enters the cockpit of power and begins quietly but efficiently to work out a plan that she has strategized about herself. A very interesting plan in which she devised a way to get into the presence of the king, which was forbidden to her. You had to wait till you were invited, even if you were one of the king's concubines or even the king's queen, you had to wait until you were summoned to get into the presence of the queen. She had risked her life to get there, to get his attention, number one, to invite him for dinner, him and his vizier, his prime minister, Haman, and then to invite him to a second meal, so that on three occasions, the king would say to her, "Anything you want, I will give to you. Anything up to half of my kingdom, I will give to you." This man, Haman, who had concocted the scheme to kill the Jews, is on that day, chapter 8, verse 1, now dead. I was reminded this week of Sir Robert Alexander Watson Watt. Watson hyphen, Watt. Watson Watt, which is very hard to say, easier now than it was at the 9 o'clock service. Watson Watt was the chief creator of radar. Radar, you may know, contributed to the shortening of the Second World War. And we're very grateful to radar, because every plane that flies successfully over your house rather than into it and lands safely at Philadelphia Airport owes a lot to radar as well as to the skill of the pilot, obviously, since we have a couple in our congregation. And we're grateful to them for getting us up and down many times. Watson Watt was in Canada. long after the war. He was in Canada in 1956, when a policeman stopped him for speeding using a radar gun. Watson Watt wrote an amusing little poem about this, which he read at a great scientific conference held in 1963 in San Francisco. It began like this. "Pity, Sir Watson Watt, strange target of this radar plot, and thus, with others I can mention, the victim of his own invention. His magical, all-seeing eye enabled cloud-bound planes to fly, but now, by some ironic twist, it spots the speeding motorist and bites, no doubt with legal wit, the hand that once created it." Well, Watson Watt was caught in his own radar, and Haman was hoisted in his own petard. He was utterly defeated. This enemy of the Jews had built this great 75-foot gallows on which Mordecai, the cousin of Esther the queen, was going to be hung in the morning of the day before that day, the day we're reading about today. And instead, that by the end of that day, he is caught in his own trap, he is utterly defeated, he is hung on his own gallows. He is the victim of his own invention. Now, we've been saying this, and we need to remind ourselves again, that Haman is presented, therefore, in this book as an Antichrist figure. Because in the Bible, Antichrist is that figure who makes the people of God his target. You may remember in the book of Revelation, in chapter 12, a picture that John is given. A sign appeared in heaven of a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, on her head a crown of 12 stars. She represents the people of God, and particularly Israel at this point. And she's pregnant, she's having a child, and there is a great dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns waiting. We're told what the dragon was. The dragon was the devil and Satan, the ancient enemy of the people of God. And he's waiting for this woman to give birth to this child who is the Messiah. And just as he's about to pounce, the child is spirited away. But this is the picture we have in the book of Esther. Antichrist is trying to eradicate the Jews because the plans of hell are that the anointed one of God will not come of a house that was being held by a strong man. The strong man was the devil, Satan. And Jesus said that while the devil or Satan is in charge, everything is okay. He keeps his house in peace. All his goods are his. All his inheritance is his. He keeps everyone who is under his power. It's all safe because he's in charge. Until a stronger than he should come along, who evicts him and turns tables on him and takes his goods and owns them. And in many ways, what we see in the book of Esther is a reprise of that kind of picture. Christ is claiming himself to be the stronger than the strong man who can cast him out and free lives that are forfeited by sin. Haman represents in this book the ancient enemy of the people of God, who are the church. And the gallows that was meant to crucify or to hang Haman becomes the very gallows on which the enemy of God is utterly defeated. And that makes us think, doesn't it, of the gospel. The devil had in his mind this great plan, you remember. His great plan was not only should the Messiah die, but that the Messiah should be killed by the Romans, who would invariably hang him to a cross. The devil doesn't know everything, but he does know his Bible. He can read it like you can read the Bible. And in the Bible it said that the Messiah was going to come from the Jews. And the Bible also said, cursed is everyone who is hung on a cross. And the devil came up with this idea, and he thought, this is one way to absolutely sabotage and destroy the power of the Messiah once and for all. Hang him to a cross, and he will be under the curse of God. And in the New Testament, when the Messiah is hung on the cross, his very being hung on the cross spelt the embarrassment and the failure and the ridicule of all of his enemies. The record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands, says Colossians, he set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities. He put them to open shame, triumphing over them in him. And by extension, in him having been crucified. So here we have the enemies of God represented by him, and they have been utterly put to an open shame. And that open shame becomes even more open as we begin to proceed now, journeying into chapter 8. And we read that on that day, Ahasuerus gave to Queen Esther the house of Haman. Here is this peasant girl, taken as a young girl along with others, perhaps as many as 400 others, taken as a sex slave to Susa, the capital, and put into the harem to service the king. And there in that harem to be in captive, not able to go out or to see the rest of the world, now locked into, sequestered, out of public sight in that harem. That was her background. She was nothing in the eyes of the world. She had nothing. Now she has the goods of the house of Haman. And God's purpose was to raise up the house of Israel here. And you notice that she, in turn, goes on now to speak more familiarly to the king. She tells the king in verse 1 what Mordecai was to her. I like the way that's phrased. It's a wonderful translation. What he was to her. Mordecai was her cousin, much older cousin. She had been bereaved of both her parents. Mordecai had taken her into his home, had brought her up as if she were his own daughter, and had lovingly cared for her. When they'd taken her away, the soldiers had taken her away, he'd followed those soldiers. He'd stayed outside of the place where she was kept. He had earnestly cared for her as much as he could from a distance. He'd been anxious for her. He'd given her advice to keep her alive while she was in under royal custody there. And the queen tells the king what he was to her. A friend, like a parent to her. And the king, who has only just discovered that Haman's plan would have taken from him Queen Esther, now feels even more gratitude as he realizes that Mordecai has cared for her over these years. And so what does he do? Verse 2, he takes off his signet ring, which had the seal, the great seal of Persia, on which was stamped on edicts whenever they were drawn up. He makes him the vizier, the prime minister of all Persia. There's a reversal of fortunes here. You say, well, it's very unlikely that a Jew would be so influential in Persia. But actually, if you read the Bible, you find there are many people like Daniel, for example, and Nehemiah, as well as Esther and Mordecai, who were influential in the Persian Empire. And in fact, we've got studies of a collection of tablets from the Persian Empire of this period, and we discover that in the lists of those who served in Artaxerxes and Darius, over 100 Jewish names of people who were exalted to high office within the imperial household. So this is not at all unhistorical. This is what happened. And there is this reversal of fortunes. Haman's inheritance is given to Esther. And do you know there you have a little picture, a snapshot in the history of redemption of God's purposes, that all the enemies of God, all their work, all that they have strived to obtain, all that they have achieved by their ingenuity and wit in the world, everything that is theirs is coming to the children of God. It is the children of God who will inherit the earth, which means that all the striving and effort and work and cunning and craftiness and scheming and plotting and planning of men and women will come to nothing. But it also means that all the creativity and all the inventions and all of the things that man has accrued in his wisdom over the centuries, all of that is coming to the children of God. Poetic justice. But now we have in verse 3 an ironic twist, because we're not out of the woods yet. Esther is, Mordecai is, they're in no danger now. But now we're reminded that the Jews are still in danger. There's been an edict passed. One of the things we're reminded later on is that the law of the Medes and the Persians cannot be revoked. Sometimes my job as I was growing up was to wash and dry the dishes. We didn't have a dishwasher in those days. Well, they did. My parents had one, and it was me. And occasionally, I would try and get out of washing and drying the dishes. My mother would remind me that me washing and drying the dishes was a law of the Medes and the Persians that could not be broken. I had absolutely no idea what she was talking about, of course. But now I know the law of the Medes and the Persians cannot be revoked. So that was one of the funny things about the Persian Empire. And that was the way it was. And so what was the law of the Medes and the Persians? It was this, that the Jews must die. But here is the wonder of chapter 8. The Jews are under this threat of death, but God has a plant. God has a plant in the royal palace. There is someone there who has God's people on their mind. Now, it's remarkable how she got there. The whole beginning of the book of Esther tells us the story. Let me remind you, in the words of C.H. Spurgeon, the great Baptist preacher of the 19th century, there in chapter 1, the king is having a party, and they're all drunk out of their minds, and quote from Spurgeon, he sent for his queen, Vashti, to exhibit herself to the people and the princes. No one dreamed in those days of disobeying the tyrant's word, and therefore all stood aghast when Vashti, evidently a woman of right royal spirit, refused to degrade herself by being made a spectacle before that ribald rout of drinking princes. This is 19th century English, of course. And refused to come. For her courage, Vashti was divorced and a new queen was sought for. That was the setup for the story of Esther. And so what happens is the king gets rid of Vashti because she stands up to him when he tries to humiliate her before the eyes of his princes. And what does he send his men to look for? Well, he wants a girl who's young. That means impressionable, perhaps malleable. You can mold her and shape her so that she doesn't do what Vashti did. I mean, Ahasuerus is not very lucky here. Vashti stood up to him, and Esther is formidable, as we see. And God has his person in place. I think we pause for a minute to say this, that whatever mischief hell it may be brewing against the cause of God and against the church of God, and there must be much going on in hell against the church of God today, the Lord knows all about it. And he has his Esther and his Mordecai ready at their posts to frustrate their designs. God has his people well placed, sometimes very well hidden in covert places, to ambush the enemy of our souls, to ambush those who rise up against the church of God and forestall their purposes and frustrate their plans. Every child of God here has been placed where God has put them, in the providence of God, in order that God might use them where they are. Maybe you're one of these people and you sometimes think, maybe I would be more useful to God as a minister or as a missionary. And the word of God is, you may be, but you may not be. In fact, most likely for most of us, the place where God has put you is exactly where God wants you to be. And he's put you there in order that you might be a plant in the kingdom of this world and that God might use you for his kingdom. Serve him where you are. Don't get frustrated that this is not kingdom work. Of course it's kingdom work. The kingdom of God grows like yeast in the dough, working its way through the system. And wherever you are, God has put you there for a purpose. So here we have then at the beginning of this chapter, the threat to Mordecai is over, the threat to the church remains, and the threat to the church was legal. There was a law of the Medes and the Persians which could not be altered. What is to be done? Look at verse 3. Esther spoke again to the king. She had run the risk once before of approaching the king without being summoned by him. She runs the same risk again by now taking the initiative. She speaks to the king. But she does more than that. She fell at his feet. Do you notice? She fell at his feet and wept and pleaded with him to avert the evil plan of Haman. Now, I kind of contrast this moment with the way we've seen Esther operating. I mean, she's been pretty cool-headed up to this point. She had a plan in her mind, which she devised herself, by the way, because remember, she said to Mordecai, you leave it to me, and I'll do what needs to be done. The plan involved getting the eye of the king without losing her head. The eye of the king would be no use if you had no head. She wanted to get the eye of the king and be admitted into his presence without being executed. And then after she got to see the king was really pleased that she was there, and he offered her up to half of his kingdom, and she said, okay, would you come round to my apartments tomorrow night for dinner and bring your good friend Haman? So they came there, and once again, the king was really pleased with the meal, and he said, I'll give you up to one half of my kingdom. What do you want? She said to him, I want you to come back again tomorrow night. And he came back, and only on the third night, can you think of how much cool-headed togetherness you have to have, first of all, to risk your life and the sense of, you can feel the adrenaline rush when the king does not order her execution, and yet she manages to keep her cool. And then the second night, wouldn't you think she'd just want to kind of spit it out? I'm a Jew. Did you know I was a Jew? I'm a Jew. And there's a law that's going to kill all the Jews. And you know, I mean, you want to talk about 100 miles an hour to get it off. But no, she's calm, cool, collected. Third night, same thing. King says, I'll give you up to a third. She says, okay. There's a plan to kill all the Jews. I'm one of them. And the killer is this man, Haman. She has been together, but she's not together now. You come to verse 3, and the dam has burst. You know how sometimes you can hold yourself when you're going through a crisis, you can hold it all together, but then there comes a moment in a sense when there is a lessening of the tension, when it all bursts forth. Can you identify with that? That's what's going on here. The dam bursts. And now that she herself is no longer in danger, she cannot help now but focus on the people of God. She falls at his feet. She pleads with him to avert the evil plan of Haman, it says there in verse 3. She is doing what? She is interceding for the people of God. You see what Esther does not say, but what we know, and what Ahasuerus does not know, is that these were not just any people. These were not just the same as all the other groups of people that had been overtaken by the Persian Empire. These were the people who were God's own people. He loved these people. He had covenanted himself to these people. He had given promises to these people. He'd given these people a way of access to him, information about himself. These people had the Word of God. These were the people of God. She is feeling this because she knows this to be the case. She understands that these are God's chosen, that they have his inheritance, that they are his inheritance. But she doesn't say that to him. Why? Well, it would be lost in him, number one. Number two, she is modeling to us what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, don't cast your pearls, that's the things you wear around your neck, don't cast your pearls before swine, that's pigs. In other words, I put a bead of pearls in front of one of my daughters, they would just take it. They'd know what to do with that. You throw them up to pigs, I don't know what the pigs would do with them. And sometimes there are things you don't say to the pigs. You don't say to those who don't understand the truth, because all you're going to do is give them fodder for their revulsion to the things of God. There are times to be silent, as we saw last time. So she doesn't tell all that information, but that's on her mind. These people are the people of the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel. The king reaches out the royal scepter. She's now permitted to speak officially, and that's exactly what she done. It switches off the emotion for a moment, regains her courtly composure, uses the language of the court, if it pleases the king, if I've found favor in your sight, if the thing seems right to the king, if I'm pleasing in your eyes, in his eyes, she's being, she's using all the language of the court. But you notice that even after using all of that courtly language, the urgency of her heart breaks out again. How can I bear to see the calamity that is coming to my people? How can I bear to see the destruction of my kindred? She is impassioned by this. You can see echoes of the kind of language that's used here of Esther in the language that the Apostle Paul uses in Romans chapter 9 when he says this, I'm speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience bears me witness in the Holy Spirit that I have a great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart, for I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kindred, my kinsmen, according to the flesh, they are Israelites. And we read the rest earlier. It's a passion for the people of God. It's a passion for these Jews. And she's coming to the king. She knows this king has it in his gift to spare them. And she is pleading with the king. She is urgent in her intercession. Kind of urgency you see Jesus talk about in another parable. When a man is wakened up one night to an insistent knocking on the door, and he opens the door, and there's a visitor, a guest, and the guest is starving and needs to be fed, and he's got no food in the house, so he goes next door, and he wakes up his neighbor. He keeps on knocking until the neighbor wakes up and comes down the stairs, and Jesus says, that's the way you are to pray. That's the way you are to call on God. There must be urgency and insistency as you beseech him, as you assault, as Spurgeon would have said, as you besiege the battlements of heaven, that God would open the doors to let down a blessing upon his church. When you're praying for the church of God, that's how you are to pray with such insistency as Queen Esther shows us here. And what is the result of her insistent intercession? The king reminds her of the edict, that is the law of the Medes and the Persians, that cannot be altered. Now, the thing about absolute monarchs is that absolute monarchs feel free to disregard laws, even laws that are unalterable. They find ways around it. You're not to draw any political parallels with any political system anywhere in the world. I'm just making a general comment about absolute monarchs. We don't have any of those today. What was to be done? Here's the king's solution. The laws of the Medes and Persians cannot be altered, but we could always issue another law, a law that contradicts the first law. And we could seal it and send it out, and that's precisely what we have happening there in verse 9. The king's scribes are summoned at that time in the third month, which is the month of Sivan, on the 23rd day. An edict was written according to all that Mordecai commanded concerning the Jews. And if you want to do your homework, compare this with chapter 3, where Haman's edict was written down. It's all the same language. It's a repetition, a very deliberate repetition of what happened back then. It's the same stuff happens here concerning the Jews to the satraps and the governors and the officials of the provinces from India to Ethiopia. 127 provinces, to each province its own script, to each people its own language, and also to the Jews in their script and their language. And he wrote it in the name of King Ahasuerus, and he sealed it with the king's signet ring. And he sent the letters by mounted couriers riding on swift horses that were used in the king's service, bred from the royal stud, saying that the king alone is the king's solution. I can't retract a law of the Medes and the Persians that says everybody is mobilized on this day to kill any Jew that's living near them anywhere in the entire kingdom. I can't stop that happening. But what I can do is this. I can say to the Jews, mobilize yourselves, arm yourselves, and be ready on that day to defend yourselves against all the enemies that will come against you. There is his solution to the problem. And at each point, Haman's edict is undone by Mordecai's edict. And there's a sense in which, you know, there is a law of sin and death that is undone by Jesus the Messiah. A law of sin and death that began to be undone when, in his resurrection, Jesus defeated the great enemy of our souls. The grave's power was broken. Christ rose in triumph. And we learn from this book, you know, there are no miracles in the book of Esther. That is, no miracles of great powers by which God suspends the laws of nature or bends them. Those miracles that make us say, look, there's the finger of God. Why doesn't God do that? No, in the book of Esther, we've been reminding ourselves there is the hand of God through the circumstances of lives lived, through their placement in the characters of the drama. God is at work behind the scenes through people working out his plan and purpose. As people do their thing, God is ruling and overruling what they do of their own will. Just as when Peter is preaching on the day of Pentecost, he says, you took the Messiah, you crucified and killed him. But know this, this man Jesus was handed over to you by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. Miracles are nothing compared to the wonder of providence in which God governs and upholds everything that he has made and bends it to serve his purpose day and daily through ordinary people in ordinary places being faithful to him. Well, we learn from this chapter how safe the church of God really is. Haman seemed to have all the power. The people of God seemed to be so vulnerable. And yet by this stage, Haman is gone and the people of God live on. The Jews live on. The Messiah comes. He comes to the house of David. He comes as a Jew. He says to a Samaritan woman, salvation is of the Jews. People come from all over the world to Jerusalem to hear about the good news of a Savior, a Messiah who comes, who was a Jew. And Christian people have been spreading the good news of the gospel to everybody, that the one who was born a Jew, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of David, is also son of God. What a great message. The foes of God cannot therefore put out the candle of God's truth. They cannot crush God's son. The Lord Jesus Christ cannot be overthrown. The people of God, bought by his own precious blood, cannot ultimately die. The wicked will surely come to an end. They may be powerful, but God is more powerful yet. They may dig deep as hell, but God will undermine them. They may rise as high as the heights of the heavens, but God will throw them down in the end. If you're here today and you're an opponent to the Church of God, I want to say to you, turn from that career, that move, that flow of your life, because it's going to end badly. It is going to end badly. Confess your sin, forsake it, and believe in Jesus. Chapter ends with joy, great joy. The Jews had light and gladness and joy and honor. And in every province, in every city where the king's command and edict reached, there was gladness and joy amongst the Jews. Celebrate, come on. There was joy and celebration, like you have at weddings, among the Jews. That's why every year the Jews still celebrate the deliverance that Esther provided. And how was this deliverance accomplished? It was accomplished because God had Queen Esther there to intercede for his people. And Esther becomes a type of Christ. We have not at the throne of a tyrant, but before the throne of God above, a strong, a perfect plea. He is at the Father's side, the man of love, the crucified. He is there interceding for us. If anybody sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He lives, he ever lives to intercede for us. And his intercession is strong. It accomplishes his purposes. And so don't be dismayed. Let your souls rest in God. Wait patiently for him. For soon heaven and earth will pass away, but those who do not trust in the Lord will perish. And they shall not, the people of God, shall not be ashamed or confounded, world without end. Amen. Father, we pray that you would take your word and fill us with great joy and peace in believing, we pray. Thank you that we have a king. We have your son representing us, as it were, in his humanity before you. And he is able to do all that we ask him to do because he is the God-man. Father, he shares your nature, your power, and your authority. And he acts on our behalf. We praise you for him. And we pray that you would bless your church in answer to his pleas. In his strong name we pray. Amen. now receive the Lord's benediction. May grace, mercy, and peace from God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen. God be with you.